is to give thanks to God. And the question you need to ask yourself is that, how prepared I am to give thanks to God? Make it a habit to be thankful to God. Make it a habit to be thankful to God. It is a position that shows that you are fulfilling the will of God. When you are thankful to the Almighty God, it shows that you are in a position fulfilling the mandate and the will of God. You see, as believers, I don't know, there's nothing that pleases me past to be doing the will of God, to know that and my life is fulfilling the will of God. And one of the ways to do that, be thankful to God. Be thankful to God. You see, I see that Jesus, anytime he wants to unlock the supernatural, what he did first was to give thanks to God. If you look at the life of Jesus, the Bible says everywhere he went, he was doing what? He was doing good. The signs and wonders followed Jesus. And then I began to think, perhaps it will be worthwhile this morning for us to look at how Jesus used thanksgiving to unlock the supernatural. The Bible records in the book of John chapter 6, verse 11, when the multitude were following Jesus, there were over so many thousands, I think 4,000 or 5,000, they were thronging Jesus. They had been with Jesus for a while. They were listening to the messages he was preaching. And then he got to a point. Jesus knew, very compassionate Lord. He knew that they were hungry. He knew that these people had been with him for a very long time. And then the Bible says he asked Philip, knowing what he wanted to do, the first thing he asked Philip is that, he said, Philip, where are we going? He said, where shall we buy bread that these people may eat? And if you look at the book of John chapter 6 verse 7, the first thing that Philip said is that, he said, where are we going? He said, even if we have 200 denaries, he said, where are we going to find? He said, it is not worth enough. He said, it is insufficient to buy bread for these people. Now, look at the way the mind of Philip operated. Jesus was asking, where are we going to buy bread to feed these people? The first thing that the mind of Philip went to is what is insufficient. He said, where are we going to get to? He said, even if we have 200 denaries, he said, it is insufficient. It is not enough to feed these people. Many a time, when we look at the situation of our lives, the first thing our mind goes into is those things that are insufficient. Those things that are not enough. Oh, I don't have this. Oh, that is not enough. But you know what Jesus did? John chapter 6, verse 11. The Bible says, when they found a boy, they asked 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. John chapter 6, verse 11. The Bible says, and Jesus took what was not enough. He took those bread. And what did he do? When he took it, somebody should read that John 11, verse 6 to us, please. John chapter 6, verse 11.
And Jesus took the loaves and went.
Now, he said, and Jesus did what? Praise the Lord. And Jesus did what? Now, was the loaf enough? But the Bible says, and Jesus took what was insufficient, what was not enough. He took the loaves. Please go on, man. When he had given thanks for what was not enough, when he had given thanks over just 5, compared to the 5,000, over what was insufficient, over what was not enough, the Bible says, and when he had given thanks, then what did he begin to do?
He distributed it.
The Bible says he distributed it. And we all know the story. The Bible records that not only did they have enough, even they had what left over. He gave thanks for what was not enough. So when he gave thanks over what was not enough, the supernatural followed. The supernatural followed. What was insufficient, he took it up and he gave thanks for it. Now, brethren, complaint may be logical, but it doesn't attract the supernatural. In that situation, if Jesus had complained, do you know that it would have been logical? After all, 5 loaves compared to 5,000. This is not enough. What are we going to do with this? Oh God, why did you put me in this situation? Why have you allowed me to lead these people? Why have you brought... He can complain and complain. But you know what? He lifted it up. What a great example. He lifted up that which is insufficient. Brethren, are you going to lift up that which you consider not enough? That which you consider is not enough. That which you consider is insufficient. Jesus is telling you this morning. He said, if you lift it up in thanksgiving, don't lift it up in complaint. Don't lift it up in murmuring. Jesus, lift those bread up. The Bible says, and he began to give thanks. Do you know that the ordinary people around will be looking at him? I believe the disciple will be looking at him. What is it? What is there to thank God for? What is there to thank God for? 5 loaves, 2 fishes, 5,000 people. What is there to thank God for? Living in a house, no heating. What is there to thank God for? I've just been furloughed. What is there to thank God for? The job is not enough. What is there to thank God for? I thought by now I would have got my own house. What is there to thank God for? I thought by now this job would have moved me forward. What is there to thank God for? Brethren, we shouldn't be like that. Jesus, over what is insufficient, he gave thanks. And then the supernatural followed. We all know that after that, 12 baskets of leftover. Do you know that, again, if you follow the example of our Lord Jesus Christ, there was a time when one of his dearest friends passed on, Lazarus. And not only was Lazarus passed on, the Bible records that he was dead for how many days? 4 days. Even the family members gave up hope. They said, Master, if you had been here on time, you would not have died. And Jesus was even telling them, he said, don't you know I am the resurrection? To know that they have lost hope permanently. Do you know what Mary said? He said, I know you are the resurrection and the life. I know he will rise up in the final day. They have lost hope on this earth. They said, we know when it comes to the day of resurrection, we know Lazarus will get up. And Jesus said, have you forgotten that I am the resurrection and the life? And you know what Jesus did? The Bible records that Jesus, when he got to the tomb of Lazarus, in front of it, the first thing he said is this. He said, roll away the stone. And when they rolled away the stone, Jesus did something very, very important. And that was what attracted the supernatural. John chapter 11. John chapter 11, verse 41. Let's see the example of Jesus. The Bible says, Jesus told them, he said, take away the stone where the dead was lying. Praise the Lord. And then Jesus did what? He lifted up his eyes. And when he lifted up his eyes, what did he do after that? You see, brethren, at times when you are in a position that things appear hopeless, what God expects of you is to do what? Lift up your eyes. He wasn't looking at the people. Because, you see, when you look at the people at times, you may be discouraged. When you look at the people at times, you might find reason not to give thanks. What is there to give thanks for? Somebody has been dead for 4 days. Somebody has been stinking. What is there to thank God for? And brethren, you know what Jesus did? The Bible says he lifted up his eyes and he said, Father, I thank thee that thou hearest me. And then after that, he said, I thank you, God, because you always hear me. Thanksgiving in front of what? In front of a tomb. Thanksgiving in front of a tomb. You see, when you stand in the place of a tomb, is not a place you give thanks. But in front of a tomb, in front of an hopeless situation, what did Jesus do? The Bible says he lifted up his voice and then he gave thanks to the Father. In that hopeless situation, are you strong enough to still find a reason to thank God? You see, he wasn't saying, Father, I thank you for Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. No. He said, Father, I thank you that thou always hear me. You see, in that city, lift your eyes away and find a reason to thank God. That God always hears you shows that he will change the situation. That God can still hear you shows that God is still in charge. You see, that thanksgiving showed God. Jesus was saying, God, I know you are still in charge of the dead and of the life. I know you are still in charge of the dead and of the living. In front of a tomb, he was still able to give thanks to God. In front of a dead and hopeless situation, he was still able to give thanks to God. Brethren, what God expects of you and I is that we give thanks to him, irrespective of the situation. Find a reason to give thanks to God. Begin to look for reasons to give thanks to God. If you find none, at least your breath is still in your nostrils. And if there is a breath in your nostril, which is the breath you did not put there in the first instance, if there's breath in your nostril, then there's hope for you. So you know that there's still hope for that tree, even if it be cut down. Even if it be what? Cut down. What is the hope for the tree? Because its root is still in the soil. Your root is still in Jesus. And because of that, there's still hope for you. The Bible says that Jesus gave thanks. And after he gave thanks, the next thing he did was what? He said, Lazarus, come forth. And you know what happened? Lazarus came out. The supernatural followed thanksgiving. Everywhere you see thanksgiving, the supernatural followed. How many of us desire the supernatural this year? God is saying that be thankful. God is saying be thankful. Be thankful to me. Irrespective of your situation, you want to see the supernatural. You want to see God come down. The moment Jesus gave thanks, God came down. And you see, wherever you see the presence of God, you can't see deadness. You can't see deadness. God came down and Lazarus rose up. There was another example of the disciples. Paul and Silas, they were accused. They were accused. These are people that are doing the work of, and then they were accused. What was the accusation? In the book of Acts chapter 16 verse 20, the Bible says they accused them. They brought them before the council. They said, these are the troublemakers of the city. These are the trouble. They have turned our city upside down. They accused them. Can you imagine you are doing God's work and people are still accusing you? You are at work, you are putting in your best, and yet people are still accusing you. You are doing the best in your heart, the way you know how to do it. These ones, what were the offense? They were preaching Jesus of the things they have seen, of the things they have heard, and yet accusation was still following it. And I see it in that situation that they had every reason to complain. Not only were they accused, do you know that they were accused in so much that they were even thrown into jail? They were locked up for what? For what? You know that in that situation, they could have descended into self-pity. Oh God, you know we are doing your work. Why are we locked up? Why are we in this situation? After all, you said if we do your work, if we do your will, miracles will follow. After all, you said you will move. God, what is happening to us? Do you know that in that situation, regret? If they were regretting in that situation, it could have been logical. After all, they were doing the will of God and they were locked in jail. After all, they were trying to please God. And what they got in return was what? Was jail. They could have descended in self-pity. Sat down, oh, look at my life. Oh, my mates are riding high now. People who say that about their mates, they have not seen their mates that are no more alive. They always talk about their mates that are better than them. What of your mates that are no more alive? What of your mates that are not where you are today? Brethren, do you know that where you are today is a prayer point for some people? Some people are secretly praying and say, if God, if you can just do for me one tenth of what you are doing for that sister, if I can just get to where you are. I remember someone was complaining one day in the UK, was complaining to someone in Nigeria. Say, oh, if you see things are so hard, things are so challenging. And the person said, let's swap. Let's just swap places. Do you know that where you are today, some people are fasting and praying. Say, God, do it. God, do it. God, do it for me. Just let me land there. That is the prayer of some people. And then you are there, you are complaining. Praise the Lord. And so Paul and Silas, doing the will of God, they were thrown in jail. And the book of Acts chapter 16 verse 25. Acts chapter 16 verse 25. The Bible says, at midnight. At midnight. Now, brethren, look at it. The Bible says, at midnight. Midnight is an hour that you expect people to be rolling in their bed. I'm saying, oh God, in jail, preaching the gospel. At midnight. Midnight is when people will lose their sleep, when things are not going on well. One said, do you know I can't even sleep? Perhaps they were unable to sleep and they rose up. What were they doing? The Bible said they were praying and they were singing hymn to God. In jail, with shackles on their feet, with chains in their hand, and they were praising God. There are many that are not in chains, and yet they find no reason to praise God. There are many, their feet are not shackled, and yet they find no reason to thank God. The Bible says in that verse 25, Acts chapter 16 verse 25, said at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymn unto God. And you know what? They were not doing it silently. You know, they were not saying, let me just thank God. No, they were not. The Bible says other prisoners were hearing them. And so it was an act, it was part of them. They didn't start it when they were in jail. Brethren, if you don't know how to thank God when you are free, when you are in captivity, when things are tough, how are you going to find the confidence to do it? Because you are not used to it. So God wants it to be a lifestyle. And so the Bible says in verse 26, as they began to pray, as they began to sing hymns unto God, as they began, I don't know what hymn they were singing. In fact, in my mind, I was just thinking, what kind of hymn were they singing? Oh God, ah, oh, eh. What does it matter? Does it line up? What hymn will you be singing in jail? What hymn will you be singing when your feet are shackled?
No.
But yet, they were singing hymn to God. They were just blessing God. They were not thinking, they were not pitying themselves. Brethren, God wants you to quit self-pity this year. Stop pitying yourself. You are not an object of pity. Jesus died for you and paid the greatest price for you. You are not an object of pity. Be thankful to the Almighty God. The Bible says, and they rose up. They began to sing praises to God. And verse 26 says, suddenly. Now listen to this. They were not thanking God because of a miracle. They were not thanking God because of a breakthrough. But the Bible says they were thanking God when they have seen nothing. And the Bible says suddenly. So thanksgiving brought down a sudden supernatural. Thanksgiving brought down a breakthrough. And the Bible says suddenly there was a great earthquake. Do you want the ground to shake for you? Begin to thank God. Do you want the supernatural to happen for you? Be thankful to God. Before you see it, be thankful. Don't wait. You see, this is talking to me strongly. Don't wait until we move into a great venue. And then you wear your abada and then you began to say, come and see. I was dancing today, saying, come and see. And I saw myself in a new building. I saw myself in a big building. That is God. That is God. And you know what? I've said it. Write it down. All of us will be alive. And we will rejoice in the same place. In the name of Jesus. And so they didn't see it. They were not in the circumstances that approve of thanksgiving. But yet, they did it. And suddenly, the supernatural began to happen. Earthquake happened. The Bible says the foundation of the prison shook. Do you want foundations to shake for you? Be thankful to God. Do you want the supernatural to happen? Be thankful to God. And the Bible says, and immediately the doors of the prisons were opened. Now listen to it. The doors, not just one single door, doors, multiple, began to open for them. You want doors to open for you in 2021? Be thankful. You want doors to open for you? Be thankful. Thanksgiving opened doors. Thanksgiving attracts the supernatural. And the Bible says, everyone's band were loosened. Not only the ones that were thankful, they were in an atmosphere of the supernatural. And so everyone there, their shackles were open. If you want the supernatural to happen, have an attitude of thanksgiving. Be thankful. Just wake up in the morning and say, Father, I just thank you. I give you praise for the anointed church. I thank you for all the souls that you have added unto us. I thank you for the promotion that everyone is experiencing. I thank you for the supernatural in the life of everyone. Thank God for your household. Thank you for what he has provided for you. Thank God for the increase. Thank God for the enlargement. Thank God for the peace of mind. There are so many. If you stand in the place of thanksgiving, you begin to see that you have so many things to thank God for. You see that you begin to have so many reasons to be thankful to God. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for increase. Thank you for enlargement. Thank you for those things you expect to see. Thank you for enlargement. Thank you for increase. Thank you for multiplication. Thank you for peace of mind. Lord, thank you for enlargement. Oh, thank you, oh God, for those miracles, oh God. Thank you for this life, oh God. Thank you, oh God, for enlargement, for increase, oh God. Thank you for multiplication, oh God. Thank you for the breath in my nostrils. Thank you for my children. Thank you for my job. Thank you for my bosses. Be thankful to God. Paul and Silas, they were so thankful. And you know what? Doors opened unto them. A miracle of suddenly, a miracle of immediate began to happen. Brethren, do you want to be losing from captivity? Then be thankful. If you are in the captivity of debt, if you are in the captivity of fear, if you are in the captivity of stagnation, if you are in the captivity of anxiety and worry, be thankful to God. Be thankful to God. I've said this so many times before, but let me just repeat it again. You know that there was a time, I remember when the church was starting in our sitting room, and I began to thank God at that time. Then there was a time I said, in the new year, I think it was 2016, 2017, or 2017 to 2018, I can't be sure now. I said, in the new year, I will not be spending in debt. You know, on that day, I was heavily in debt. It's like being in a captivity of debt. That situation does not permit me to make such a declaration of faith at all. In fact, the week that followed it, my car broke down. It's so much that I had no cash to even repair it. I had to still use credit card. But yet, I made that declaration then. As I was making the declaration, it was as if the devil was mocking. It was as if the situation was getting more bitter. It was as if the situation was getting more terrible. Brethren, you know what? Very recently, I looked back and I saw that absolutely no debt. Hallelujah. Absolutely no debt. Paid off. Hallelujah. If I owe it, it's because there is enough cash to pay it off. Hallelujah. Not because there is no cash. And so I saw my situation. And when the declaration was made, I didn't look like it at all. There was no way. If you ask me how, I will tell you I don't know how. And that was the sincere truth. But you know what? The debt got bigger. But when God came, God became bigger than the debt. And wiped it out within how many weeks. Brethren, be thankful to God. That captivity, you may not know how, you may not know when, but you know what? You know God. You know God. Be thankful to Him. There is nothing He cannot do. There is nothing He cannot do if only we are thankful. Make Thanksgiving your lifestyle. Don't be a complainer. Don't be a complainer. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Make praises, Thanksgiving, make it a lifestyle. Make it a lifestyle. When you are driving on the motorway, just say, Father, I thank you. Maybe you want to get there on time and there's traffic. Just say, Lord, I thank you for this comfortable car because I can enjoy it longer. Traffic is there, but I can enjoy it longer. So, Lord, I give you thanks. I give you, make it a lifestyle. David said seven times. He said three times he will pray, but seven times I will praise. So that, think of that ratio. Three times he prays, but how many times? He gave thanks to seven times. So that's more than 100 times. That's more than 100% of how much time he prays to God. Make it a lifestyle. Brethren, this year, 2021, don't join the band of complainers. Don't join the band of complainers. You know that? You know, there's something that complaint does. It releases destruction. I'm telling you, and I'm not making it up, brethren. It releases destruction. 1 Chronicles chapter 10 verse 10. 1 Chronicles chapter 10 verse 10. Complain releases destruction. The Bible says, and they put 1 Chronicles chapter 10 verse 10. So 1 Corinthians, sorry, I said Chronicles. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 10. I want us all to look at the lifestyle of a complainer. The Bible says, neither murmur as ye, as some of them also murmured, and were what? I want us to look at the screen. Please, if you have another, let's look at it in so many versions this morning. He said, neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were what? And were destroyed by the destroyer. Murmur brings destruction. It brings destruction. Who else has another version? Maybe a simpler version. Because all this ye and ye will confuse us a bit. But let's just see it in another version.
And do not murmur.
And do not murmur.
Unwarranted discontent.
Unwarranted discontent.
As some of them did.
As some of them did.
And were destroyed by the destroyer.
And were destroyed by the destroyer. You see, somebody said something and I love it so much. He said, complain, murmur. He said, it's a project for destruction. He said, it just lined you up for destruction. Don't complain about your job. Don't complain about your spouse. Don't complain about your finance. Don't complain about your church. Don't complain about people around you. It brings destruction. The Bible says, when they complain, do you know the children of Israel? If you look at the book of Numbers, Numbers chapter 11. The book of Numbers chapter 11. Numbers chapter 11, if you look at verse 5, they were complaining. In fact, if you look at verse 1 first, maybe verse 1, Numbers chapter 11, verse 1, if you look at it, they were a band of complainers. These are the people that God has parted Red Sea for. These are the people that they have crossed the other side and they've entered the wilderness. And they are there. What was the next thing that they did? The Bible says they began to complain. And they provoked the anger of God. And the Bible says fire came down. And those that were on the edges, the Bible says fire consumed them. Destruction. You will see a pattern there. Those complaining. The Bible says, and when the people complain, and he did what? It displeases the Lord. You know when the Bible says, tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 18 that thanksgiving is the will of God. Complaining is what? It displeases the Lord. The Bible says it displeases the Lord. And when the Lord heard it, now, brethren, when you complain, whether in secret or in open, God hears. You don't need to say you are praying and you are complaining. When you just go about and say, oh, everything is just not too okay. Oh, I don't even understand this spouse. Oh, God will have just given me a better husband. This one is just horrible. Oh, God will have just given me a better church. God will have just given me a better church, a better boss. Do you know that God hears it? The Bible says, as you have said in my hair, so I will do to you. So, while they were complaining, they were not praying. So, don't think that it's only by prayer that God will hear. Every time we take the position of complaining, God is hearing. Every time we take the position of thanksgiving, God is also what? He's also hearing. The Bible says, and God heard it, this, and he heard it. He heard it. And the Bible says, his anger did what? He burned. Ah, God help you, us. If what we do is to provoke the anger of God, I pray the anger of God will not be burned against us in Jesus' name. And the Bible says, the anger of God burned, and so fire burned them and consumed them at the edges. That is what complaint does. Murmur brings destruction. Complaint brings destruction as well. And you know what? These people, they complained, isn't it, in verse 1. And they saw fire. And you know what they did in verse 5 again? They murmured. Let's look at it. Numbers chapter 11, verse 5. The Bible says, and this, you see, God will help us. These are the people that God was feeding with manna. They didn't plant, they didn't harvest, they didn't labor. All they had to do was just to sleep and wake up, and manna will fall from heaven. And then they began to complain. Oh, all we have been eating. They began to murmur. All we have been eating is just this manna. Ah, we remember in Egypt when we used to eat fish. When we used to, the cucumber of Egypt. Oh, that garlic of Egypt. Oh, the leek. You see, I've said it before. I went to ask that. Deliberately, I was thinking of Numbers 11, and I was looking for, because in Nigeria there is no leek, and I leek just like it's just like a root. And in my mind, I was, why will a grown-up man be crying for leek, garlic, fish, onion, and gusa, onion? They were crying. Those were the things. I said, we remember. You see, when they were in Egypt, these are the things they were. Their master was beating them, and God said, I have seen the burden of my people, and then he delivered it, and yet they were remembering with nostalgia. Egypt said the fish we used to eat freely. They were not eating. It is a lie. They were laboring. Mm-hmm. Said we used to eat it freely, and the cucumber, and the melon, and the leek, and the onions, and the garlic. Some people don't even like garlic, and these are crying over garlic. They were murmuring, and you see, I want us to know the difference between complaining and murmuring this morning. And I'm dwelling on it a bit so that we will not be in that mood in the new year. When you complain, it's an expression, a loud expression of discontent. See, you know, they complain to the boss, everything is not moving well in this organization. Things are not right, you are not doing it well. They voice their discontent, whereas there will be a lot that are going on well. And so they voice out their complaint. Now, when it comes to murmuring is a subdued type of complaint, a subdued kind of expression of discontent. Things are not going on. You don't understand what is happening. Everything is just, or you may not even hear. You don't. That is murmuring. They're just saying things. Subdued one, a private one. Now, people subdue it when it comes to complaint because you think that people will point you out as a complainer. Then within, start murmuring. You are not saying it, but you know what? God is still what? Hearing. And the Bible said that when they were murmuring about fish, melon, garlic, and leek, when Moses was passing through their tent, all the people, all of them began to weep. They began to cry. And one thing I saw there is that all it takes is just for you to have one complainer and it will start spreading. Only one of them started it, and then it spread all through the camp. Everybody, you see, people did not now see the good anymore. Just because of a complaint, it blindfolded them of the victory that God has given them. And the only thing they saw was things that are not, only that manna was a problem. Manna became, what was a blessing, became a point of complaint. They began to murmur, oh, these children, oh, this, what God gave them freely that they didn't work for. Then it became an object of complaint. Now, brethren, listen to this. Children as well, never complain. Your parents bought you Adidas, and then you are saying, oh, I want Puma. Oh, why would my parents not have given me Puma? I want the latest. Oh, this one is just 2020. I want the latest. This is not 2021 fashion. When you complain, God hears it. Oh, no new dress. They say this is new year. Where is the new dress? Where is the new thing? Have you not heard that there are people that don't even have clothes? Oh, where is the new shoe? Don't you know there are people that don't even have legs? Not to talk of wearing a shoe. They complain, they murmur. And you know what? Each time we complain, those who complain don't rise to the top. Those who murmur, they don't get to the top at all. They don't lead anything. God don't find them to lead it. God don't see them qualified to lead anything because they murmur. Can you imagine in an organization, do you think complainers rise to the top? Those who say, boss, this thing is not going well, but what can we do to help? What can I do to put in an effort to make it better? They are the ones that rise to the top. Those who complain, they are the ones that they weary people. They weary people that are close to them. You know when the people complain, you know what Moses did? Verse 10, Numbers chapter 11, verse 10. Numbers chapter 11, verse 10. Moses, who was their leader? Numbers chapter 11, verse 10. The Bible said, then Moses heard the people weep throughout their families, and every man in the door of his tent, they were doing it privately. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them. Now, we know that it draws the anger of God, but what does it do to people around them? The Bible said, and Moses himself was displeased. And so, complaining and murmuring, not only does it displease God, people that are around you become overwhelmed, they become weary of you. Why? Because everything you see is, oh, it's not going well. It's not right. Oh, they are not doing this to me. They should have done that to me. It wearies out. It displeases man and it angers God. When you murmur, you become a burden. You become a burden. In verse 14, Numbers chapter 11, verse 14, the people became a burden unto Moses as a result of their murmuring. The Bible says that when Moses heard the people weeping throughout, Numbers chapter 11, verse 14, he said, Moses got to a point, he said, God, I am not able to bear all these people alone because they were too what? They were too heavy for me. Well, because of murmuring, because of complaint, they became a burden. If you complain at work, you become a burden to your boss. He may not express it, and you know the British are very polite. They may not express it, but internally you become, you know, when they turn their back, they will just roll their eyes. They've come again. There we go. You know, that's their, here we go. But they will not tell you. They will just say, all right, we'll find a way to make it better. But when they turn their back, they say, here we go again. Why? Because you are not the only one there. The question is, how can I make it better? It wearies, it displeases God, it wearies man. Moses got to the point, he said, I am not able to bear this. He said, am I the one that conceived them? He said, am I the one that conceived them? He said, why did you put their burden upon me? And God was saying, okay, don't worry. Appoint 70 others. Let them share this burden with you. Don't let all the complaint come to you. We will not become a burden in the name of Jesus. Our attitude should be an attitude of thanksgiving. And you know what? Thanksgiving is what God expects. He expects it from us. It's an expectation in his heart. So when you are not doing it, you are not fulfilling an expectation in the heart of God. Have you forgotten that story in the book of Luke chapter 17, verse 17 to 19? When 10 lepers, they were healed. And Jesus was surprised that out of the 10, only one came back. Jesus said something. He said, were there not 10 cleansed? He said, where are the 9 others? So he was expecting that it was 10 people that would come back. He said, were there not 10 lepers clean? He said, where are the 9? And in verse 18, Luke 17, verse 18, he said, has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner? So that means the other, all of them were Jews. Only one Samaritan out of the lepers came back. One who had no relationship with God was the one that came back. He said, was no one found to turn back and give praise to God except this foreigner? And you know what Jesus did to that foreigner? Verse 19. He said, arise, go thy way. He said, thy faith has made you whole. You see, there is wholeness in thanksgiving. There's completeness in thanksgiving. And that is what God expects us to do. Now, brethren, I want to say this. Don't just be thankful because God has done something or because he hasn't done something. I think be thankful because you have a relationship with him. Be thankful. Don't be thankful just because, oh, when I thank God, then the supernatural will happen. Be thankful that you are in a relationship. Be thankful that you are in a relationship. You know, when our children say thank you for what we have done, when our children, it's because they are in a relationship with us. Be thankful because you are just in a relationship with God. Be thankful that you have a father. Be thankful that he is your God. Be thankful that he's just in charge of your life. Let's have an attitude of gratitude in the new year. And as we do that, the supernatural will follow. As we do that, the supernatural will follow. This morning, we're going to be rising up. We're going to be dancing. We're going to be praising God. Please, don't be civilized in your thanksgiving. Don't be civilized. Don't say, oh, with this, the way we do it in UK, we just clap 2 by 2. No. Don't be civilized. Thank God. Be lavish in your thanksgiving. Be lavish in your praises to the Almighty God. Very soon we'll be thanking God. But I just want us to do it lavishly this morning. I want us to be lavish in our praises. I remember that song as I was preparing this message this morning. Say, I will praise you, Lord, with every breath that I have. I will praise you, Lord, this promise I've made, till eternity ends, and start all over again. Even then, I will praise you, Lord. Come on, church, join me. I will praise you, Lord, with every breath that I make. I will praise you, Lord, this promise I've made, till eternity ends, and start all over. Let's take it one more time. I will praise you, Lord, with every breath that I take. I will praise you, Lord, this promise I've made, till eternity ends, and start all over again. Your voice in thanksgiving to the Almighty God. Lift your voice in thanksgiving to the King of Kings. Begin to thank him. Begin to worship him. Father, you are my maker. Lord, you are my King. Father, I worship you. Lord, I exalt you, God. Lord, I give you praise, O God. Father, I worship you, O God. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
Amen.
Please, I want the Holy Communion to be given out this morning. And as it's been given out, I still want you to continue to begin to praise God. I still want you to begin. Don't make any requests this morning. Just be thankful to God. Thank Him for His faithfulness. Thank Him for the 365 days that has gone. Thank Him for the 365 days that is ahead of you. Thank Him for the miracle of sleeping. Thank Him for the miracle of waking up. Thank Him for the open doors. Thank Him for the enlargement. Thank Him for the favor. Thank Him for the open doors. Thank you. See how God has caused you to escape. See how God has caused you to escape lack. How God has caused you to escape death. How God has caused you to escape breakdown. Lord, I thank you, God. Over the anointed church, Lord, I thank you. Over every life, I thank you. Over the careers of your people. Over the businesses of your people. Over the children, oh God. Over the adults, over the men, oh God. Over their household, oh God. In time of pandemic, you rescue them. You rescue them. You save them, oh God. Father, we give you praise, oh God. Lord, we exalt you, oh God. Father, we give you praise, oh God. Lord, we give you thanks, oh God. Father, we exalt your holy name, O God. Father, we exalt you, O God. This morning, if you have had your Holy Communion element, as you're giving thanks to God, I just want you to take the body. The Bible says, by His stripes, ye were healed. We are taking this Holy Communion this morning in thanksgiving. His body is broken for you. Thank Him because you are in a covenant relationship with the Almighty God. Thank Him because you are a daughter. Thank Him because you are a son. Thank you because that body was broken for you. I want you to take the body now this morning. And as you're taking it, I want you to begin to be thankful. Say, Jesus, I thank you because you are my God. I thank you because you are my... I thank you because I know you. I could have been in the pub this morning. I could have been somewhere else wrecking myself. I could have been lying down, sleeping, being ungrateful to God. But this morning, I'm on my feet. I'm in the presence of the people of God. I'm God, and God, I am worshiping you. Lord, I am grateful that your body was broken for me. Father, I thank you, O God. As we take the blood as well, I want you to be mindful of the victory that our blood has given you. By His stripes, you were healed. I want you to think of how His body was broken and blood gushed out. And the Bible says that blood stood as an atonement for your sin. The Bible says that we are more than conquerors by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of His testimony. That is what gave you victory. Any victory you and I can claim this morning, any victory that we are going to claim later, any supernatural that we are going to be entitled to later, it is because of that blood. Without that blood, we stand no chance. But you know, because the Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. That blood brought us back to God. It gave us the access to the Father. So this morning, be thankful.
Lift up our voices and pray for Pastor.
choir.
Virtue has been released from him, and I just want us to pray that God will refill him in the name of Jesus. He will never be empty in the name of Jesus. He has always been a man of thanksgiving, and praises of God will not cease from his lips in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we ask, O Lord, that as he releases unto your diluted word of God, unto anointed church, that every day as I sit in the presence of the Lord God Almighty will fill him to the brim until he overflows in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you because we know that you've answered our prayers. In Jesus' wonderful name, we have given thanks. Amen. I will just run quickly through the announcement that we have before we share the grace. Fasting and prayer starts tomorrow, and that's from Monday until Sunday. 7 days fasting and prayer. There would be online prayer meeting at 12 noon, and we will also meet in the church in the evening from 7 to 8 every day. And there would be a retreat on Saturday as well, 11 to 3 p.m. Throughout this week, because we are going to be meeting physically at church between 7 and 8, we are not going to be having online prayer meeting at 8:30 this week. So please remember to come to church with your family and friends for the fasting and prayer. And I pray that God indeed will hearken unto our voice in Jesus' name. As we close this service, I just want you to pray and speak to your week. I want you to say to God, what do you want? With thanksgiving in your heart, as we have heard this morning, we are not going to be complaining. We are not going to be murmuring. We are going to be giving thanks to God. But speak to your week. The Bible says, as Pastor said this morning, that as you have said in my ears, so will I do unto you. Speak to your week. Say to Jesus that, Lord, these are my expectations. You know what the Bible says? The expectations of the righteous will not be cut short. So your expectations will not be cut short. That God, all throughout this week, every day of my life, clothe me with the garment of praise. I step into this new week with thanksgiving in my heart. I will walk throughout this week and beyond with thanksgiving in the mighty name of Jesus. Doors will open of their own accord unto us in the mighty name of Jesus, because we are going to be filled with thanksgiving. Father, we give you praise. We decree God's blessing and God's favor upon the church in the mighty name of Jesus. We step out of this place fruitful. We will return with thanksgiving and testimonies in the mighty name of Jesus. Surely his goodness and his mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.